met 'n begroting van 3
miljoen,
'n miljard rand, is hoër onderwys en opleiding die derde grootste begrotingspos in die Suid-Afrikaanse begroting. Hiervan gaan 80% na die universiteite. Die beursskema vir arme mense en die werkersklas NSFAS beloop byna 35 miljard rand. Dit beteken slegs 7 begrotingsposte, of 8 as ons die res van hoër onderwys bytel, is groter as NSFAS. Mense sou dus dink dat NSFAS met die grootste sorg tot stand gebring sou word. Die teendeel is egter waar, en sake is eers na die spreekwoordelike treinongeluk reggeruk. In die voorkeurlys vir besteding is hoër onderwys baie hoog. Dit word daardeur bevestig dat net 1,7 miljard rand as 'n netto bedrag van die aanvanklike 97,4 miljard rand met die noodbegroting besnoei is. Nog so wat 8 miljard rand het verlore gegaan omdat vaardigheidsheffings nie in 'n stilstaande ekonomie ingesamel kan word. Dit bring ons by die kernvraag van enige begroting. Kan die staat hierdie spesifieke besteding regverdig, dit bekostig en dit volhou? Which also involves the debate on decolonization and white privilege. The current political, economic, scientific, educational and even recreational system is an outflow of the global predominance of the West century through conquest and affirmed during the 20th century through increasing globalization. It cannot be disputed that the child born within the continuity of Western civilization, even in a less privileged position, has an advantage to a child born out of that continuity. That was the Afrikaner experience of the early 20th century, when society in South Africa was thoroughly British. Such situation confront one with a threefold choice: to relinquish one's own identity in order to assume another, to complain about the injustice, or to compete head-on by fusing one's own background with the predominant systems of the time. The third choice can't be made on one's own. One needs a collective, and preferably a state, to do that. Japan was the first country to actually succeed in doing that, followed by the Southeast Asian tigers, China, India, and more recently several Arabian countries. As a matter of fact, that is what Europe did during the 11th and 12th centuries, when it emulated and appropriated knowledge which was first construed in Africa and Asia. Continuity with the classical civilizations of Greece and Rome, with its own original contributions, facilitated this. In this fusion of cultures, which is the only way to remove cultural disadvantage, universities play an indispensable role. The African university has the historical imperative to immerse itself in the Western academic tradition, but to remain African. Therefore, humanity should never be regarded as less important than the natural sciences. It would be highly advantageous to develop at least one Nguni and one Sotho language as languages of academy. It would be disadvantageous to regard Afrikaans as merely a barrier to entrance. However, these good things do not happen. Historically, at disadvantaged universities stick to English, and Afrikaners are branded as racists if they attempt to maintain their own legacy of decolonization. In the post-school education and training sector, funding is not a problem, execution is. Die begroting kan regverdig word as dit goed bestee word. Of dit na die ekonomiese vernietiging van die Grendelstaat volgehou kan word, tyd sal leer. Ek dank u.